Showcase Sundays today on the Mutual Audio Network.
The following audio drama is rated PG for parental guidance recommended.
San Francisco in the roaring 20s is a city that hasn't quite shaken her old self. Scratch the surface of civilization, and out pumps the hot, chaotic blood of her Barbary Coast days. Sometimes, somebody needs help bringing order back to this chaos, and that's where I come in. I work for the Federated Detective Agency.
Audio presents Adventures of the Federated Tec. Created by Pete Lutz and Mark Slade, and dramatized from stories by Dashiell Hammett.
This time, a trip south of the border to find a runaway husband leads to a triple murder north of the border and the deadliest love triangle you ever heard of.
Tonight's story, The Golden Horseshoe, Part 1, adapted for audio by Pete Lutz.
I haven't anything exciting to offer you this time. I want you to find a man for me. A man who's not a criminal.
There was an apology in Vance Richmond's voice. The last couple of jobs he'd thrown my way had run to gunplay and other forms of rioting, and I suppose the attorney thought anything less than that would put me to sleep. Was a time when he might have been right, when I was a young sprout of 20 or so, newly attached to the Federated Detective Agency. But the 15 years that had slid by since had dulled my appetite for rough stuff. I don't mean that I shuddered whenever I considered the possibility of some bird taking a poke at me, but I didn't call that day a total loss in which nobody tried to puncture my short, fat carcass.
The man I want found is an English architect named Norman Ashcraft. He's about 37, 5 feet 10 inches tall, well-built and fair-skinned, with light hair and blue eyes. 4 years ago, he was the typical specimen of the clean-cut blonde Britisher. He may not be like that now. Those 4 years have been rather hard ones for him, I imagine. I want to find him for Mrs. Ashcraft, his wife. Here's the story. 4 years ago, the Ashcrafts were living together in England, in Bristol. Mrs. Ashcraft, it seems, is of a very jealous disposition.
And poor Norman was always rather high-strung. What's more, he had only what he'd earned as an architect, while I was bequeathed quite a large amount after the death of my parents. Norman felt very self-conscious about being the husband of a wealthy woman, and was inclined to go quite out of his way to show that he wasn't dependent on my money, that he wouldn't be influenced by it. Foolish, of course. But just the sort of attitude a man of his temperament would assume. I'm afraid I lost my temper with him one night, accusing him of paying too much attention to another woman. It was a terrible row, and he packed a bag and left. It was a silly quarrel, and I learned within a week that my suspicions had no foundation outside my own jealousy. So I tried to find him, but he was gone. It soon became evident that Norman had left England. I had him searched for in Europe, Canada, Australia, and the United States. I traced him from Bristol to New York, and then to Detroit, where he'd been arrested after a drunken row of some sort. After that, he dropped out of sight until he bobbed up in Seattle 10 months later.
I've got a memorandum here. Yes, on May 23rd, 1923, he shot and killed a burglar in his hotel room there. The Seattle police seemed to have suspected that there was something funny about the shooting, but had nothing to hold Ashcraft on. Then Ashcraft disappeared again, and nothing was heard of him until just about a year ago. Mrs. Ashcraft had advertisements inserted in the personal columns in the principal American cities.
I sent a letter to him, addressed to the general delivery window here, and used another advertisement to tell him about it. His response was rather caustic. I wrote him again, asking him to come home. He refused, but his words were a little less bitter. We ended up exchanging several letters. And in the course of things, I learned that he was a drug addict. And what was left of his pride wouldn't allow him to return to me until he looked and felt more like his former self. I persuaded him to accept enough money from me to straighten himself out. I sent him this money each month in care of general delivery here in the city.
Meanwhile, she closed up her affairs in England and came to San Francisco to be on hand when her husband was ready to return to her. A year has gone by. She still sends money to him every month, and she still waits for him to come back to her. He has repeatedly refused to see her, and his letters are evasive, filled with accounts of the struggle he is having, making headway against the drug one month, slipping back the next.
I have resigned myself to the belief that he has no intention of ever coming back to me, that he has no intention of ever giving up the drug to which he is addicted. He's been using me as a source of income, nothing more.
Under the circumstances, dear lady, I would advise you to discontinue this monthly allowance for a while. Doing so would bring about an interview, I think, and you could learn definitely what to expect.
No. No, I can't do that to Norman. You see, I blame myself for his condition. I blame my foolish flair of jealousy for his plight, and I can't bring myself to do anything else to hurt him or induce him to hurt himself further.
You sound as if your mind is made up on the subject.
It is. Please don't get me wrong. I want him back. Want him straightened out. But if he will not come, then I'm content to continue the payments for the rest of his life. But I would like to know what to expect. The uncertainty of it all is... Well, I'd like to put an end to that, at least.
Interesting situation. What did you have in mind for me?
What we want is for you to find Ashcraft. We want to know whether there's any likelihood of his ever becoming a man again, or whether he's gone beyond redemption. There is your job. Find him, learn whatever you can about him, and then, after we know something, we'll decide whether it's wiser to force an interview between them or not.
I'll try it. When does Mrs. Ashcraft send him his monthly allowance?
On the first of every month.
Today's the 28th. That'll give me 3 days to wind up a job I have on hand. Got a photo of him?
Unfortunately, no. Mrs. Ashcraft, immediately following their quarrel, destroyed everything she had that would remind her of him. But I don't think a photograph would be of any great help at the post office. Without consulting me, Mrs. Ashcraft watched for her husband there on several occasions and did not see him. It's more than likely that he has someone else call for his mail.
See you around the second of the month. On the afternoon of the first, I went down to the post office and got hold of Lusk, the inspector in charge of the division at the time. Lusk and I had worked together before on a kidnapping case. I've got a line on a forger from up north who's supposed to be getting his mail at the general delivery window. Will you fix it up so I can get a spot on him?
Sure thing.
Post office inspectors are all tied up with rules and regulations that forbid them giving assistance to private detectives except on certain criminal matters. But a friendly inspector doesn't have to put you through the third degree. You lie to him, so he'll have an alibi in case there's a kickback. And whether he thinks you're lying or not doesn't matter. So, a little while after clearing things with Lusk, I was loitering within sight of the window marked A to D, with the clerk instructed to give me the signal when Ashcraft's mail was called for. It was too soon for Mrs. Ashcraft's letter to be ready that day, but I wasn't taking any chances. I stayed on the job until they closed at 8 p.m. At a few minutes after 10 the next morning, though, I got my action. One of the clerks gave me the high sign. A small man was walking away from the window with an envelope in his hand. His face was pasty, his feet dragged, and although his clothes were fairly new, they needed brushing and pressing. He came straight to the desk in front of which I stood, fiddling with some papers. Out of the tail of my eye, I saw him take a large envelope from his pocket. It was already stamped and addressed, I could see, but he kept that side of the envelope close to his body, so I couldn't read it. Once he got it sealed and headed over to the mailing slots, I went into action, pulling the old reliable stumble trick. Ow! Oh, sorry. Here, let me help you out. Oh, come on.
just take my hand. Here, come on up. Oh, hey, you dropped something. Let me get it.
No,
I got it. No, here. Just trying to help. I had the address, but in so doing, I tipped my mitt. There was no way on God's earth that this little man could have missed the fact that I'd been trying to get that address. As I watched him leave by the Mission Street exit, I committed it to memory. The outside envelope had been addressed to Edward Bohannon, care of the Golden Horseshoe Cafe, Tijuana, Baja California, Mexico. I trotted after the fellow, knowing that I couldn't let him get away with what he knew. He couldn't be allowed to tip Ashcraft off before I got to him. I had to try another trick, just as ancient as the one I just pulled. Hello, Mickey. How's everything in Chi?
You got me wrong. I don't know nothing about Chi.
Quit stalling. You fell off the Rattler only this morning.
Me? Who do you think I am?
You're Mickey Parker. The Dutchman gave us the rap that you were headed here. They got him, if you don't already know it.
You're cuckoo. I don't know what the hell you're talking about.
That was nothing. Neither did I. But I kept up the charade. I raised my right hand inside my overcoat pocket. Now I'll tell one. See this? Just keep your hands away from your clothes, or I'll let the guts out of you.
Hey, listen, brother. You got me wrong. On the level. I ain't Mickey Parker, and I ain't been in Chi for 6 years. I've been here in Frisco for a solid year, and that's the truth.
You gotta show me.
I can do it. You come down the drag with me, and I'll show you. My name's Ryan, and I've been living on six or eight months now.
Ryan?
Yeah, John Ryan.
The name was likely a fake, but I didn't let on. I don't suppose there were three old-time yeggs in the country who haven't used the name John Ryan at least once. It's the John Smith of yeggdom. This particular John Ryan led me around the corner to a house on 6th, where the landlady, a rough-hewn woman of 50 with bare arms that were haired and muscled like the village smithies, assured me that her tenant had, to her positive knowledge, been in San Francisco for months, and that she remembered seeing him at least once a day for a couple of weeks back. Now, if I'd been really suspicious that this Ryan wasn't my mythical Mickey Parker from Chicago, I wouldn't have taken the woman's word for it, but as it was, I pretended to be satisfied. And now Ryan himself seemed to be convinced that I wasn't interested in the Ashcraft letter. But even though I'd be reasonably safe in letting the situation go as it stood, loose ends have always worried me. You can't always count on people doing and thinking what you want. So, what do you do for a living?
I ain't been doing nothing for a couple of months. But I'm expecting to open up a lunchroom with a fella next week.
Let's go up to your room. I want to talk to you.
Okay, you said you want to talk? Talk.
Where's Ashcraft?
I don't know what you're talking about.
You'd better figure it out, or there's a nice cool cell down in the booby hatch that'll be wrapped around you.
You ain't got nothing on me.
What of it? How'd you like to do 30 or 60 days on a vagrancy charge?
Ha! You can't vag me.
If I were you, I'd be a nice, obliging fellow and do my talking now. Hey, don't do that. What you got there? Trying to pull a rod on me, eh? I'll take that.
Fine. I'll tell you. I don't want no trouble. And it ain't nothing to me. This Ashcraft told me he was just stringing his wife along. He gives me $10 a throw to get his letter every month and send it to him in Tijuana. I knowed him here. And when he went south 6 months ago, he got a girl down there. I promised I'd do it for him. I knowed it was money. He said it was his alimony. But I didn't know there was nothing wrong.
What sort of hombre is this Ashcraft? What's his graft?
I don't know. He could have been a con man. He's got a good front. He's an Englishman. And mostly goes by the name of Ed Bohannon. He hits the hop. I don't use it myself. But you know how it is in a burg like this. A man runs into all kinds of people. So don't ask me what he's up to. All I do is send him his money every month and get my 10.
That was all I could get out of him. He couldn't or wouldn't tell me where Ashcraft had lived in San Francisco or who he'd mobbed up with. However, I had learned that Bohannon was Ashcraft and not another go-between, and that was something. I couldn't afford to let him run around loose until I got in touch with Ashcraft. He would have been sending a telegram before I was three blocks away, and his quarry would be on his merry way to points north, south, east, and west. Ryan squawked his head off when he found out that I was going to vag him anyway.
You said you'd spring me if I talked.
I did not. But even if I had, when a guy flashes a rod on me, I figure it cancels any agreement we might have had. Come on. Nabbing Ryan turned out to be a good play. The captain of the city jail came out to give me the news.
Say, we just fingerprinted that fella you brought in, and guess what? Turns out he's actually Fred Rooney, alias Jamocha. Smuggler, wanted by the feds for crushing out Leavenworth with 8 years of a tenor still unserved.
Well, I'll be. Can you sew him up for a couple of days? I've got work to do that'll go smoother if he can't get any word out for a while.
Sure. The federal people won't take him off our hands for 2 or 3 days. I'll keep him airtight till then.
From the jail, I went up to Vance Richmond's office and turned my news over to him. Ashcraft is getting his mail in Tijuana. He's living down there under the name of Ed Bohannon, and maybe has a woman there. I've just thrown one of his friends in the cooler, the one who handled the mail. Turns out he's an escaped con.
Was that necessary? We're really trying to help Ashcraft, you know.
I could have spared this bird, but what for? He was all wrong. If Ashcraft can be brought back to his wife, he's better off with some of his shady friends out of the way. If he can't, what's the difference? Anyway, we've got one line on him safely stowed away where we can find it if we want it.
All right. Is Mrs. Ashcraft there? This is Mr. Richmond. No, we haven't exactly found him, but I think we know where he is. Yes. In about 15 minutes. We'll run up to Mrs. Ashcraft's house and see her.
Mrs. Ashcraft, I've been told your husband is in Tijuana. He left San Francisco about 6 months ago. His mail is being forwarded to him in care of a cafe there under the name of Edward Bohannon.
That is good news. Shall I go down, Mr. Richmond, or will you?
Neither. You certainly shouldn't go, and I can't. Not at present. I must be in Eureka by the day after tomorrow, and shall have to spend several days there.
Then I'll go.
Yes, you'll have to go. You can no doubt handle it better than I could. You will know what to do and how to do it. Your course will have to depend on Mr. Ashcraft's attitude and condition. Mrs. Ashcraft doesn't wish to force herself on him, but neither does she wish to leave anything undone that might help him.
Mrs. Ashcraft held a strong, slender hand out to me. I took it. It felt cool. Her blue eyes looked at me with an expression of confidence.
You will do whatever you think wisest.
I will. I like this Mrs. Ashcraft. Tijuana hadn't changed much in the 2 years I'd been away. Still the same 600 or 700 feet of dusty and dingy street running between two almost solid rows of saloons, perhaps 35 of them to a row, with dirtier side streets taking care of the dives that couldn't find room on the main street. The automobile that had brought me down from San Diego dumped me in the center of town early in the afternoon, and the day's business was just getting underway. There were only 2 or 3 drunks wandering around among the dogs and loafing natives in the street, although there was already a bustle of potential drunks moving from one saloon to the next. But this was nothing like the crowd that would be here in the following week when the season's racing started. In the middle of the next block, I saw a big gilded horseshoe. I went down the street and into the saloon behind the sign, where a greasy orchestra was now preparing to go to work. It was early in the day, and there were only a few buyers present, so the girls whose business it is to speed the sale of drinks charged down on me in a flock.
Buy me a little drink.
Not just yet, ladies, all right? I need a little breathing room. That's right, that's right. I'll see you later. Bye.
something?
I want to see Ed Bohannon.
I don't know no Ed Bohannon.
If a man who says he's Ed Bohannon asks for that, will you give it to him?
I guess so.
Good. I'll hang around a while.
Uno, dos, tres, cuatro.
Buy me a little drink?
The lanky girl who had done something to her hair that made it purple was camped beside me before I'd settled in my seat. The face she made at me was probably meant for a smile, and the strange noise she made after she'd asked her question was probably supposed to be a laugh. Whatever they were, they beat me. I was afraid she'd do them again, so I surrendered. Sure, sure, what'll you have?
Whiskey, Pedro. A double.
Si, senor?
Just a bottle of beer for me.
Okay.
The beer wasn't bad for green beer, but at $4 a bottle, it wasn't anything to write home about. This Tijuana happens to be in Mexico, by about a mile, but it's an American town run by Americans who sell American artificial booze at American prices. If you know your way around the United States, you can find lots of places, especially near the Canadian line, where good booze can be bought for less than you're soaked for the poison in Tijuana.
Well, down the hatch. How about another one, honey?
Aura, Frank wants you.
What? Oh, it's you. All right, Cupie. Will you take care of my friend here?
Cupie slid into the chair Cora had just vacated. She was a little chunky girl, hardly a day over 18. Just a kid, really. Her short hair was brown and curly over a round, boyish face with laughing, impudent eyes. Rather a cute youngster. I bought her a drink and got another bottle of beer. What's on your mind?
Hooch. Gallons of it.
And besides that?
I hear you're looking for a friend of mine.
That might be. What friends you got?
Well, there's Ed Bohannon for one. You know Ed?
No, not yet.
But you're looking for him.
Uh-huh.
Maybe I could tell you how to find him. If I knew you were all right.
It doesn't make any difference to me. I have a few more minutes to waste, and if he doesn't show up by then, it's all one to me.
Aw, what's the racket? Maybe I could get word to Ed.
Have a smoke. Let it go. This Ed of yours seems to be exclusive as all hell. Well, it's no skin off my face. I'll buy you another drink and then trot along.
Now, wait a minute. I'll see if I can get him. What's your name?
Parker will do as well as any other.
You wait. I think I can find him.
I think so, too. 10 minutes went by, and a man came to my table. He was a blonde Englishman of less than 40, with all the marks of the gentleman gone to pot on him. You could see evidence of the downhill slide plainly in the dullness of his blue eyes and in the grayish tint of his skin. He was still fairly attractive in appearance. Enough of his former wholesomeness remained for that. He sat down, facing me across the table.
You're looking for me?
You're Ed Bohannon?
Uh-huh. Your note said, Jamocha is cocked. Is that supposed to mean something to me?
That's for you to decide. Jamocha was picked up a couple days ago and ought to be riding back to the Kansas Big House by now. He got word out for me to give you the rap. He knew I was headed this way.
How did they come to get him?
Dunno. Maybe they picked him up on a circular.
Did he tell you anything else?
He didn't tell me anything. He got word out to me by somebody's mouthpiece. I didn't see him.
You're staying down here a while?
Yes, for 2 or 3 days. I've got something on the fire.
Thanks for the tip, Parker. If you'll take a walk with me, I'll give you something real to drink.
I don't have anything against that. He led me out of the Golden Horseshoe and down a side street to an adobe house, set out where the town fringed off into the desert.
Sit down. What do you fancy? Rye? Gin? Tequila? Scotch?
The last one wins. He brought in a bottle of black and white, a siphon, and some glasses, and we settled down to drinking. We drank and talked, and each of us pretended to be drunker than he really was, though before long we were both as full as a pair of goats. It was a drinking contest, pure and simple. He was trying to drink me into a pulp. a pulp that would easily give up all of its secrets, and I was trying the same game on him. Neither of us made much progress. All that afternoon, we faced each other over the table in the center of the room, drank and entertained each other. Along about dark, Bohannon was leaning pretty heavily on one elbow and waxing philosophic.
You know, I've been a damn ass. Got a wife, the nicest woman in the world, and yet I hang around here, lapping up this stuff, hitting the pipe, when I could be somebody. Can't seem to break away. Going to, though. No spoofing. Going back to the little wife, nicest woman in the world. Don't you say anything to Cupid. She'll raise hell. She knew I was going to shake her. Nice girl, Cupid, but tough. Stick a blooming knife into me. Look at me. Parker, do I look like a hophead? Course not. I can take it or leave it. Look, I'll show you. Take a smoke now. Show you I can take it or leave it alone. Be right back. Feel like a fighting rooster. Feel better than I ever felt. Feel like a fighting rooster. Feel better than I ever felt. Got double euphoria and still think I got the best health. Doggone, I got more money than Henry Ford or John D. ever had.
He came staggering into the room again, carrying an elaborate opium layout. All silver and ebony on a silver tray. He put it on the table and flourished a pipe at me.
Have a little rear on me, Parker.
I'll stick to the scotch, thanks.
Give you a shot of C, if you'd rather have that.
Cocaine's not my weakness. You go ahead.
All righty.
Bohannon sprawled himself comfortably on the floor beside the table, rolled and cooked a pill, and our party went on, with him smoking his hop and me punishing the liquor, each of us still talking for the other's benefit and trying to get the other to talk for our own. I was holding down a lovely package by the time Cupid came in at midnight.
Looks like you boys are enjoying yourselves. Hello, Ed.
Everything's love, lovely.
Any of that scotch left?
I'm glad you're here.
Oh, that's nice. Why?
Want to dance?
What's keeping you?
No. Want to dance with you.
Oh, I see. But there is no music.
Ed was singing a minute ago. I got the tune in my head. Come on, dance.
You want to stay oiled all the time, Shorty. It improves you.
Thank you. did we dance?
Yes, and it was lovely. Thank you.
My pleasure. Oh, look, Ed's asleep. Good idea. I'll just lie down next to him. Night, QP.
Good night. Painless.
On a cold winter night, not a star was in sight, and the north wind was howling down the line. With his sweetheart so dear, stood a brave engineer with his orders to pull old number 9.
A good night's sleep on the train between San Diego and San Francisco set me down in the 3rd and Townsend station with nearly normal head and stomach and not too many kinks in my nerves. I put away a breakfast that was composed of more food than I'd eaten in 3 days and went up to the agency office to see the old man.
So, you spent 3 days drinking in Tijuana. How's your liver?
Another day of it and I wouldn't have made it back. If Bohannon, or rather Ashcraft, and I weren't drinking, we were sleeping off what we'd drunk. I guess we hit every joint in town and made that adobe house our headquarters. He and I were thick as thieves on the surface, but neither one of us ever lost his distrust to the other, no matter how drunk we got, and we got plenty drunk.
As long as you're achieving what you set out to do. I recall some years back, I was in your shoes, tracking down a killer. but I was north of the border in the Yukon, and the Canadian liquor is much smoother than scotch, if I remember correctly. And I don't believe opium was involved in my case.
Well, Ashcraft went up against his mud pipe pretty regularly. I don't know if the girl used the stuff. I don't think she did, but she had a pretty capacity for hard liquor. I'd go to sleep not knowing whether I was going to wake up or not. Luckily, I didn't have anything on me to give me away, and I figured I was safe unless I talked myself into a jam. At the end of the 3 days, I made an excuse and headed back north.
Is your work with Mrs. Ashcraft complete?
There's only breaking the news to her. When we're done here, I'm going over to Vance Richmond's office to make those arrangements.
How much of what you've discovered do you plan to tell her?
I know what I'm not going to tell her. Actually, I've put together a mental list, and I wouldn't mind hearing what you think of it.
Of course. I'm listening.
So, Ashcraft suspects that I went down to see him on his wife's account. He was too smooth and entertained me too well for me to doubt that. Next, he's apparently decided to return to his wife, though there's no guarantee he'll actually do so. Three, he's not incurably addicted to drugs. He merely smokes opium, and regardless of what the Sunday supplements say, an opium smoker is not much worse off than a tobacco smoker. Four, he might pull himself together under his wife's influence, but it's doubtful. He hasn't gone to the dogs physically, but he's had his taste of the gutter, and he likes it. And lastly, the girl Cupie is crazy in love with him, while he likes her, but isn't turning himself inside out over her.
I believe I can surmise what you won't be telling Mrs. Ashcraft.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Richmond is still in Eureka. I don't expect him back until the first of the week.
Can you get him on the phone for me? She could, and did. Without mentioning any names, I told the attorney what I knew and guessed.
I see. Suppose you go out to Mrs. A's house and tell her. I'll write her tonight, and I probably shall be back in the city by the day after tomorrow. I think we can safely delay action till then.
All right, I'll go out now. No one seems to be at home. Hello, newspapers in the vestibule, and they're this morning's and yesterday morning's. Sir, excuse me.
Yeah?
Do you know if the people who live here have gone away?
I don't guess so. The back door's open. I seen this morning. They may have gone. Come to think of it, I ain't seen any of them for... I don't recollect seeing any of them yesterday.
Thank you. I left the front steps and went around the house, climbed the low fence and back, and approached the kitchen door. It stood open about a foot. Nobody was visible in the kitchen, but there was a sound of running water. There was no answer to my knock, so I pushed the door open the rest of the way and stepped in. The sound of water came from the sink. I stepped over and looked in. Under a thin stream of water running from one of the faucets lay a carving knife with nearly a foot of keen blade. The knife was clean, but the back of the porcelain sink, where water had splashed with only small scattered drops, was freckled with red-brown spots. I scraped one of them with a fingernail, dried blood. Things went to hell pretty quickly after that. I struck a match on the far side of the kitchen before going up the back stairs and discovered Mrs. Ashcraft's Filipino houseboy sprawled half on, half off the steps. He was in his underclothes. His throat had been cut, straight across, close up under his chin. I stepped over him carefully and went up. My second match showed me the button. I walked down the hall, turned the corner, and nearly stumbled over a woman who lay there. She wore a nightgown, and her hair was in a braid down her back. She was the maid who had admitted Richmond and me 4 days ago. She died, clutching a gaping wound in her stomach. I stepped around her and pushed open a bedroom door. It was an expensively dainty bedroom in cream and gray, with French prints on the walls. Nothing in the room was disarranged except the bed. The bedclothes were tangled and rumpled and piled high in the center of the bed, in a pile that was too large. Leaning over the bed, I began to draw the covers off. The second piece came away stained with blood. I yanked the rest off.
Mrs. Ashcraft was dead there.
Got hold of this time.
Oh, Gar, am I glad to see you. I found three bodies in there before I quit looking. Come on in. Maybe a regular detective like you, with a badge and everything, can find more.
Three, eh? You didn't do bad for a lad.
My wooziness had passed. I was eager to get to work. A sleuth who doesn't grow a tough shell is in for a happy life, day in and day out, poking his nose into one kind of woe or another. We didn't find any more bodies other than those three. Detail work occupied all of us, Ogar, the eight men under him, and me for the next few hours. When the bulk of the reports were in, Ogar and I sneaked away from the others.
It's you and me jaw a bit. Library's nice and quiet. Night before last, huh? Wednesday night?
All reports seem to point that way, or early Thursday morning.
I'd say the killer cracked the back door, picked up the carving knife in the kitchen, and went upstairs. Maybe he went straight to Mrs. Ashcraft's room, or maybe not. But after a bit, he went in there. The lady had a torn sleeve and scratches on her face, which tells me that there was a tussle between her and the killer. The Filipino, the maid, heard the noise, heard her scream, maybe, and rushed to her room to see what was the matter. The maid probably got hers first. The killer had to chase the houseboy down the back hall, caught him just at the top, slit his throat, and let him fall down the stairs. Then he went down to the kitchen, washed his hands, dropped the knife, and blew.
So far, so good. But I notice you skip lightly over the question of who he was and why he killed.
Don't crowd me. I'll get around to that. I'm guessing one of the three options. The killer was a maniac who did the job for the fun of it. Or a burglar who was discovered and ran wild. Or finally, somebody who had a reason for bumping off Mrs. Ashcraft. And then had to kill two servants when they discovered him.
The burglar guess doesn't seem likely.
Ah, you're right. Taking the knife from the kitchen is a bad play. A good prowler would bring his own weapon with him. And besides, we're pretty sure nothing was stolen.
And it's hardly ever a maniac.
Right again. But my personal guess is that the job was done by somebody who wanted to wipe out Mrs. Ashcraft.
Not so bad. Now listen to this. Mrs. Ashcraft has a husband in Tijuana, a mild sort of hophead who's mixed up with a bunch of thugs. She was trying to persuade him to come back to her. He has a girl down there who's young, goofy over him, and one tough doll. He was planning to run out on the girl and come back home.
So?
So, I was with both him and the girl in Tijuana night before last when this killing was done.
So? Yeah.
Sorry to bug you, Sarge. Your friend's got a phone call downstairs.
Thanks. It was Vance Richmond. I told him the whole thing.
I'll leave for the city tonight. You go ahead and do whatever you want. You're to have a free hand.
Right. I'll probably be out of town when you get back. You can reach me through the agency if you want to get in touch with me. I'm going to wire Ashcraft to come up in your name.
Very well. My God, it's such a tragedy.
City jail? Let me talk to the captain. Oh, hi, Cap. Listen, is John Ryan, alias Fred Rooney, alias Jamoka, still in your custody?
Nope. Federal officers left for Leavenworth with him and two other prisoners yesterday morning.
Up in the library again, I told Ogar hurriedly, I'm catching the evening train south, betting my marbles that the job was made up in Tijuana. I'm wiring Ashcraft to come up. I want to get him away from there for a day or two, and if he's up here, you can keep an eye on him. I'll give you his description, and you can pick him up at Vance Richmond's office. He'll probably connect there first thing. Half an hour of the little time I had left, I spent at the agency writing and sending three telegrams. The first was to Ashcraft. Mrs. Ashcraft is dead. Can you come immediately? Signed, Vance Richmond.
Hello again. I didn't expect to see you so soon.
Oh, I'm glad you're here. Will you please take and have these two wires coded and sent to our branches in L.A. and Kansas City?
Of course. Did the Ashcraft case take a sudden turn for the worse?
It sure did. Mrs. Ashcraft and two of her servants were murdered while I was down in Mexico. I found their bodies and have been with the cops for a few hours. Now I'm headed back down south. Got to catch a rattler in half an hour.
And I assume these wires are in connection with Sam?
Yeah. This one, for Kansas City, is for an op to visit Leavenworth in quest of a bird named Jamocha, who I'll tell you about later. The one for Los Angeles is asking for one of their men to meet me in San Diego tomorrow.
Leave it to me. Safe travels.
Thanks. I've got just enough time to hit my rooms for a bag of clean clothes. See you soon.
You have been listening to The Golden Horseshoe, Part 1, Episode 8 of Season 2 of Adventures of the Federated Tec. Our cast consisted of the following players: Pete Lutz as the Tec, Noah Diamond as Vance Richmond, Amanda Sisk as Mrs. Ashcraft, Carol Cron as the Landlady, Jeff Moon as Ed Bohannon, Paul Arbisi as Lusk and Jamocha, John Bell as the police captain, the bartender, and Pedro, Frank Guglielmelli as the neighbor, Angela Young as Cora and the stenographer, Rhiannon McAfee as Cupie, Joe Stofko as the old man, and Jason D. Johnson as Ogar. The theme and some incidental music were composed and performed by Dr. Ross Bernhardt. The Golden Horseshoe was written by Dashiell Hammett and was published in the November 1924 issue of Black Mask magazine. Mixing and mastering were performed by Daniel French of Fishbonia Sound Design. This program was adapted by and produced under the supervision of Pete Lutz. This is Darren Rockhold speaking. Please join us next time when the Federated Tec says...
It's all I can do to avoid knives, guns, and an angry girl as I try to bring a man who isn't quite what he seems to justice south of the border.
Yeah, 63 audio.